There were many milestones during the record player's long history. One of them was the Tonearm technology called linear tracking. In this video, we're going to explore all the breakthroughs that led to its creation, its concept, and how it's still considered by many as a solution to one of Turntable's biggest problems. Let's jump into it. Technology and innovation have been part of music reproduction history since its foundation. The phonograph was the first device that could record and replay sounds, and was invented by Thomas Edison in 1877. It was an intent to play back recorded telegraph messages and to automate speech sounds for transmissions by telephone. Alexander Graham Bell, whose credit with inventing the first practical telephone, made several improvements in his Volta laboratory during the 1880s and introduced a graphophone, which included the use of wax-coated cardboard cylinders and a cutting stylus that moved from side to side in a zigzag groove around the record. In the 1890s, Emil Berliner initiated the transition from phonograph cylinders to flat discs, with a spiral groove running from the periphery to near the center, coining the term gramophone for disc record players. There were commercial advantages to a disc system, since these flat discs could be easily mass-produced by molding and stamping, and it required less storage space. The record itself was maybe the component that saw more improvements during the first few decades of existence. Early materials in the 19th century were hardened rubber, wax, and celluloid, but in the beginning of the 20th century, a shellac compound became the standard. Since shellac was not hard enough to withstand the wear of steel needles on heavy tonearms, a filler made of pulverized shale was added. Shellac was also fragile, and records often shattered or cracked. This was an increasing problem, but to solve this, in 1930, RC8 Victor made unbreakable records by mixing polyvinyl chloride with plasticizers in a proprietary formula they called Vitrolac. The formula improved throughout the 1930s, and by the end of the decade, the material by then called vinylite was being used in records sent to radio stations for radio shows and radio commercials. It was important because vinyl records could be now sent through the mail without breaking. Record company engineers took a much closer look at the possibilities of vinyl, perhaps that it might even replace shellac as the basic record material. After the war, the two leading record companies in America, RCA Victor and Columbia, perfected two new vinyl formats, which were both announced in 1948, when the 33 RPM LP was introduced by Columbia, and the 45 RPM single was brought by RCA Victor. Record sales boomed after the Second World War, as industry standards changed to the new formats introduced by RCA and Columbia. When these fine-groove vinyl records became the new norm in the late 1940s, smaller and lighter crystal cartridges with semi-permanent jeweled styluses became more and more common. In the mid-1950s, these were joined by a new generation of magnetic cartridges that had very little resemblance to their crude ancestors. They allowed far smaller tracking forces, and so the balanced tonearm came into use. The tonearm holds the pickup cartridge over the groove, while the stylus tracks the groove with the desired force to give the optimal compromise between good tracking and minimizing the wear and tear of both the stylus and the record groove. At its simplest, a tonearm is a pivoted lever free to move in two axes, vertical and horizontal, with a counterbalance to maintain tracking pressure. But these new tonearms also brought a rather geometrical problem to turntables. The playback of a record should mimic the path inscribed during the cutting process of a master disc as closely as possible. During the cutting process, the cutter diamond makes an angle of 90 degrees at all instances, from the beginning of the groove to its end. Yet, because conventional tonearms have a curved swing, they are not able to hold the cartridge in such a way that it remains tangent to the record groove. These swivel-mounted tonearms change the cartridge angle with respect to the groove as the arm travels from the outer edge of the record towards the label. The number of degrees by which the cartridge angle differs from true tangent at any particular moment of the play is called tracking error, and it makes the stylus ride askew in the record groove, causing distortion. Engineers from different manufacturers started to work on a solution to this problem in the mid-1950s, and so they came up with linear tracking. Unlike conventional tonearms, these linear tracking models do not swing across a record, swiveling on a pivot. Instead, the arm slowly crawls over the record in a straight radial line, inching its way from the outer grooves towards the center. This alters the whole geometry of groove tracking, eliminating the so-called tracking error. Early developments in linear turntables were from American companies Reg O'Coot, TrueLine and Orthosonic, although they never achieved mass production. More successful implementations came during the 60s and 70s, with Revco's SL-8 tangential arm or the now legendary Beogram 4000 by the Danish hi-fi brand Bang & Olufsen. In the early 1980s, many manufacturers discovered the linear tracking principle, not so much for its correct technique, but rather creating a new incentive for music lovers to buy yet another turntable. The difference was that now the world center for cutting-edge electronics technology and innovation was Japan. All major brands like Sony, Pioneer and JVC jumped on the bandwagon and started to bring new stylish designs to market. Panasonic, being the largest Japanese consumer electronics company, brought many other advanced new technologies through Technics, their audio equipment division. One major contribution was the first direct drive turntable, the SP-10, first introduced in 1969. It was succeeded by probably the most popular deck in history, the Technics SL-1200. The originality of the design consisted in the platter being directly driven by the motor, without utilizing intermediate wheels, belts, or gears as part of the drivetrain. This required great engineering, with advanced electronics for acceleration and speed control. One brand that went quite under the radar for many Westerners was Aurex. In 1969, some high-end models of audio equipment, sold by the giant electronics manufacturer Toshiba, began to be given a different brand name, and after 1975, it was officially named as the company's pure audio brand. It became significantly independent, and its position was well established in the audio world. A commercial with a strong appeal to jazz lovers made the brand gain huge popularity among this particular audience. Until the first half of the 80s, the company was developing audio products not only in-house, but also in collaboration with audio makers such as Kenwood. Aurex had enough resources flowing from Toshiba to make high-end turntables that combined the two most cutting-edge technologies from that time, linear tracking and direct drive. In 1983, just right after the release of the compact disc, Aurex came up with the SR-L7F, a tangential direct drive turntable with a very minimalistic and futuristic kind of look. I was always very curious about Aurex, and especially about linear tracking technology, so when I saw this unit on my local eBay, I didn't hesitate. The unit was in great working conditions, so I just plugged it to my sound system and it was up and running right away. I did two quick tests of speed and wah and flutter using a test LP. Starting with the speed test, the playback of the 1 kHz track delivered a very accurate signal, between 1000 and 1010 Hz, with little fluctuations thanks to the very stable direct drive system. The wah and flutter track, playing a 3150 Hz signal, gave us a distortion average of 0.1%, which is quite acceptable. Not as good as my Riga RP3, but quite close. The functions are quite straightforward: a button to start and stop the spinning platter, and one to raise and lower the tone arm. We also have the option to move the arm horizontally in both directions, which allows the user to switch between tracks. Finally, a speed button to change between 33 and 45 RPM, and perhaps one of the most requested functions on all turntables, a repeat button. Have that on and you will loop your favorite records without the need to stand up and pull back the tone arm. That is very convenient. And of course, I play a few records and I have to say I'm very pleased with the warm and clear sound quality. Here's a little fragment of music I've recorded directly with my Zoom H5, but I will also upload a file to archive.org to bypass the YouTube compression. Link will be in the video description. Okay, so let's draw some conclusions. Linear tracking not only eliminates tracking error, but also cancels side thrust or skating force, which makes conventional arms lean harder against one side of the groove. This side thrust, nowadays compensated by special anti-skidding adjustments, is caused by the offset angle for the cartridge holder in conventional arms. Linear arms have no such offset angle, so the problem never arises in the first place. On top of all that, linear arms are usually shorter than the pivoted kind. This makes them lighter and less likely to jump when steered by powerful bass waves in the groove or the up and down swings on a warped record. Finally, linear track arms don't depend on gravity and counterweights to provide the correct stylus pressure, using constant spring tension instead, so they can play in any position, even standing up vertically. Sounds too good to be true? Let's talk about drawbacks then. The mechanism that guides a linear tracking arm is very complex. They don't just rest on the groove and move naturally from side to side. There is a sensor in the arm that detects small deviations from the true tangents between the arm and the groove, and then activates a system that pushes the arm far enough as to be again in a 90 degree angle respect to the groove. The process repeats itself over and over again till the arm covers the whole length of the record. Detractors point out that the tiny corrections made by linear tracking arms fall far short of the theoretical optimum, because it takes a definite diversion from true tangency to get the corrective mechanism going in the first place. That creates an angle sometimes in par with the tracking error produced by good quality pivoted arms. Many engineers agree that this results in no sound quality difference whatsoever in between both types of tone arm. Two other major cons are: first, the very difficult procedure of repairing or serving a tangential arm system, and second, the lack of availability of the type of cartridge or stylus they commonly use. If you don't live in a big city, then sending one of these heavy units through the mail for a small adjustment could be a real pain. So where does all this information leave us? Absolutely nowhere. In my own experience, linear tracking turntables paired with a good cartridge can reproduce sound of great quality, and are able to track even the most difficult basic groove paths with impressive clarity. They are just different, and sometimes we just love concepts that came from someone thinking outside the box. I hope you enjoyed the video. There are many turntable manufacturers that are still making linear tracking models to this day. Unfortunately, they're on the high-end side of the spectrum, but if you're lucky, you might find one of these great Japanese prototypes from the 80s. Thanks for watching, until next time.